नमस्कार, यू ऑल आर वेरी मच वेलकम इन आर ऑनलाइन क्लासेस वीडियो सीरीज। आई हर्ष इनानिया, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर इन गवर्नमेंट लॉ कॉलेज अजमेर, शैल बी टीचिंग यू द इमरजेंसी प्रोविजंस एज आर कंटेन्ड इन इंडियन कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन। ओके, सो लेट अस बिगिन। We had understood the various types of emergencies and we had completed Article 352 and Article 353 and we are to continue with Article 354. So far we had understood that while the proclamation of emergency is in operation, the President has the discretionary power to seize the operation of the provisions with regard to the distribution of revenue between the union and states. Okay, and that can be seized only for such a period which shall not extend beyond the expiration of the financial year in which such proclamation of emergency ceases to be in operation. Okay, so all the provisions with regard to the distribution of revenues between the union and the states, or any of the provisions in between articles 268 to 279 can cease to have operation by virtue of the use of the discretionary power of the President, who shall obviously work in accordance with the aid and advice of the union cabinet. Okay. So, in that particular order, it will be mentioned that the operation of the particular provisions between Article 268 to 279, whatever is wished, shall cease to have operation for that financial year's end or for that particular time period, which is very much within the time duration within which the proclamation of emergency is in operation. And he can also subject his order to such exceptions and such modifications as he thinks fit. All right, now let us understand the next clause. The next clause, that is clause 2 of Article 354, reads: every order made under clause 1 shall, as soon as may be after it is made, be laid before each house of parliament. So the use of the word shall is very much making the intention of constitution framers that it is a mandatory provision. Okay, so therefore every such order issued by the President of India with regard to the ceasing of the operation of any of the articles between 268 to 279 or all of them, such an order ceasing the operation of such provisions as mentioned by me shall be soon be laid down before each house of the parliament. Okay, so it is the beauty of the democracy that every such order's issuance, which is touching upon the fabric of our federalism, is laid down before the houses of the parliament for their approval. Okay, so the sanction of the houses of the parliament has to be obtained with regard to the issuance of order under Article 354. Now let us understand the various grounds for the proclamation of emergency as were mentioned under Article 352. The first one was on the ground of war, proclamation of national emergency can be imposed. The second one was external aggression. And the third one is armed rebellion. Okay? So, on the ground of these three points, national emergency can be very well be imposed. Okay? We all know the formal declaration of war and the use of the armed forces by one nation against the other nation is the situation of war. Okay? But what we do see in the modern times is the use of external aggression. In external aggression, what happens is one country uses its forces and utilizes as much as power against the other nation without the formal declaration of the war. Okay? So, such state of affairs in which the other nation do not take an action till that time, it is external aggression. Okay? So, one state tries to put aggression against the other state. Okay? So, that is external aggression. In a gist, I have explained. Armed rebellion. The word armed rebellion was substituted for the internal disturbance by the 44th Constitutional Amendment Act 1978. As we all know that the armed rebellion word is very specific and in which if emergency is imposed, then the country can be clear that specific grounds do exist for its imposition. So let us look on to the gist of 44th Constitutional Amendment Act 1978. But let me summarize this for you. By virtue of the 44th Constitutional Amendment Act, various restrictions and various checks were levied upon the uncontrolled power of the Union to impose national emergency. So therefore, what we need to understand is such powers has to be utilized in a very wise manner, and if an extreme situation arises, then and only then such powers has to be utilized. So therefore, what was done is under Article 352, the amendment substituted the ground of internal disturbance with armed rebellion. The word armed rebellion is altogether more specific, whereas the use of the word internal disturbance was too vague. So therefore, in order to utilize the exercise of national emergency under the point of armed rebellion, now a specific situation must exist by virtue of which the national emergency can be imposed on the grounds of armed rebellion. Okay, so the intention underlying the substitution of the words internal disturbance by the word armed rebellion was to limit the invocation of Article 352 only to more serious situations wherein the threat to the security of the country or a part thereof actually existed, and the reason underlying the restricting the scope of Article 352 is that proclamation of emergency under 352 has very wide and serious ramifications on the power of the states as well as the fundamental rights of the people. So therefore, it was done so accordingly. The President shall impose emergency only when the Union Cabinet communicates to him in writing about their decision to do so. Earlier, it could have been done only by oral communication, and that too only by the Prime Minister. So now what is done is the written communication is altogether more essential, and that too on the written communication by the Union Cabinet. Okay, so now the President shall impose emergency only when the Union Cabinet communicates to him in writing about their decision to do so. Okay, so it is a mandatory provision now. The proclamation is required to be approved by both the houses of Parliament by resolution within the period of 1 month instead of 2 months by a total majority of the membership of each House of Parliament and by the ratification of not less than 2/3 of the members present and voting in each House instead of simply a simple majority. Okay, so it is the use of check and balance. Okay, now what is done is the special majority is required to ratify the proclamation of emergency by both the houses. Earlier it was not so, now it has become more difficult to impose emergency after the expiry of 1 month of proclamation of emergency. Okay, so since it needs approval by both the houses, it cannot be obtained now easily as it requires special majority. Now let us understand the various case laws which are to be read along with Article 352 and related articles, which specifically deals with the national emergency. The first case is Naga People's Movement of Human Rights versus Union of India, AIR 1998, Supreme Court, 431, page number. So the judgment by the Honorable Supreme Court in this case was that it held that the term internal disturbance has a wider connotation than the term armed rebellion, as armed rebellion is likely to pose threat to the security of the country or a part thereof. Okay, while the internal disturbance, though serious in nature, would not pose threat to the security of the country or a part thereof. So let us understand the ratio decidendi, the reason, the concept, the logic behind the apex court's decision. It was that the use of the armed rebellion words shows that such a grave situation has arisen or it can arise that can threaten our national security. Okay, so the whole it can threaten either the whole of the territory of India or a specific part of it, whereas the internal disturbance, though it can be very serious as well, but it need not pose threat to the security of the country. So by using this specific word, the Parliament has made its intention very clear that only the situations which do pose serious and grave threat to the security of this nation calls for the exercise of national emergency on the ground of armed rebellion. The next case is Indira Nehru Gandhi versus Sri Raj Narayan and others, Appeal Civil 887 of 1975. The bench of the Supreme Court constituted of the following judges: Justice A. N. Ray, H. R. Khanna, K. K. Matthew, M. H. Beg, Y. V. Chandrachud.
On August 10, 1975, 39th Constitutional Amendment Act 1971 was brought and it inserted Article 329A, which barred the Supreme Court to entertain the matter relating to the elections of President, Vice President, Speaker of the Lok Sabha and the Prime Minister. Okay, so what happens is, by virtue of the 39th Constitutional Amendment, now the apex court's power of judicial review is barred with regard pertaining to the matters of the elections of the Honorable President, Vice President, Speaker of the Lok Sabha and the Prime Minister. We all know that the Supreme Court is the final protector of the fundamental rights and it has to protect the constitutional scheme as well as the fabric which holds the nation together. So therefore, the power of judicial review is altogether more important, and we do know in our day-to-day lives that by virtue of this exercise of the power of judicial review, various times the fundamental rights of the people of this nation have been protected. So the issue before the Honorable Supreme Court was whether the 39th Constitutional Amendment Act 1971, which referred the power of judicial review from the court's domain, whether that was constitutionally valid or not. So in its judgment, the Supreme Court held that the clauses 4 and 5 of Article 329A created by 39th Constitutional Amendment Act 1971 was constitutional, therefore void, as these clauses are calculated to damage or destroy the rule of law, okay, which is the basic tenet of Indian democracy, which is a basic feature of our constitution, that the rule of law shall prevail. No one else rules us, but the law shall triumph, the law shall prevail. So therefore, rule of law, we have also understood by the various postulates as given by the Dicey. Okay, so rule of law should prevail, and it calls for the exercise of power of judicial review as and when required. So thank you very much for listening so carefully to this video. So we do end the topic of national emergency hereby. Have a great day.